John Murray Press Audio presents Mindfulness, the Audio Masterclass by Martha Langley, read for you by Hetty Baynes Russell. The Teach Yourself series has been trusted around the world for over 75 years. This audiobook is designed to help people at all levels and around the world to understand important topics. Learn the details that matter by listening to this clear, practical, and comprehensive audiobook. Section 1. Mindfulness Made Easy. Preface to the second edition. Mindfulness originated in Buddhism, and as such, it's part of a much wider set of beliefs and behaviours. However, in recent years, non-Buddhists have become interested in mindfulness, and the concept has gradually moved across from the religious context to a more secular one. Of course, some people still embrace the entire Buddhist philosophy of life, but you don't have to do that to benefit from mindfulness. In fact, you can take on as much or as little as you want or need. For most people, the benefits are directly related to how much effort they put in. But in any case, it's entirely up to you what you do. Mindfulness is a way of learning to live with yourself and the world you find yourself in. It will help you feel more comfortable and more at ease, and the phrase, comfortable in your own skin, pretty well sums up what mindfulness is about. Achieving this highly desirable state requires you to undergo a mental journey, learning different ways of being inside your own head, and come to that, your own body. This audiobook will focus on the practical ways in which mindfulness can help you. If you find yourself being drawn to deeper issues, you will find plenty of help online and in other books. See the Taking It Further section in your supplementary PDF. There are more spiritual forms of meditation which tend to require greater discipline from the practitioner, but this audiobook will help you find out whether meditation is for you before you plunge into those more challenging forms. Much has happened since the first edition of Mindfulness Made Easy was published. Mindfulness has become more mainstream. Celebrities have written books about it, and generally speaking, mindfulness is seen as the new miracle cure. However, there is still a place for a simple, secular, jargon-free audiobook that makes the central concepts of mindfulness accessible. That's Mindfulness Made Easy. How to use this audiobook. Before you start, get hold of a high-quality notepad or open a file on whichever electronic gizmo you prefer so that you can make notes of your experiences while you're learning about mindfulness. You'll hear frequent references to keeping a journal throughout the audiobook, so decide beforehand how you want to do that. You will need to refer back frequently to what you have written earlier in order to build your learning, so take care to number the exercises so it is easy to find them. An accompanying PDF is available to show detailed diagrams and concepts. Part 1 of the audiobook takes you through the various aspects of mindfulness and some of the more general ways in which it can be helpful. You'll find a series of exercises which start very gently and which will ease you into the various activities and ways of looking at the world associated with mindfulness. These will probably seem strange at first, so take your time, repeating the exercises a few times each until you feel ready to move on. It's worth listening to all of Part 1 first, as it provides a complete overview. You can choose to either do each exercise before you listen on, or listen to the whole thing before going back and working through the exercises. Don't, however, kid yourself that listening to an exercise is as good as doing it. It isn't. By the end of Part 1, you'll have begun to decide whether mindfulness is something you want to pursue. You can't really tell, though, until you've given it several weeks. I suggest 8 weeks. During that time, you can establish a regular, ideally daily meditation practice. In part one, you'll also discover that there are other mindfulness tools and you will have explored each one. Part two looks at more specific ways in which mindfulness can be helpful, from managing stress to improving relationships. You can, as with part one, listen to it all, or you can listen to only the chapters that seem especially relevant to you. Throughout, there are exercises and tasks to help you. Part 1, Mindfulness Skills. Chapter 1, Becoming Mindful. In this chapter, you will learn the difference between being and doing, about doing and your emotions, about the problems of being on autopilot, and how to become more mindful by noticing what is around you. Think back to the last time you had a pleasant surprise, an unexpected gift, a promotion or bonus, or some good news about a health scare. Think about how you felt at that moment, whether you were relieved, excited, astonished, or overwhelmed. You no doubt were entirely caught up in the moment. Seconds before, you might have been feeling tired or worried about money or feeling thirsty. All those physical and emotional feelings would have disappeared in the suddenness of the unexpected surprise. Of course, the moment doesn't last very long. The surprise soon wears off, although you may enjoy the memory for a long time afterwards. Mindfulness encourages you to live every moment with the same intensity and the same letting go of worries and concerns, but without the need for a surprise to make it happen. Being and doing. A newborn baby spends its days apparently doing nothing, just being. Its parents, on the other hand, are quite likely to be in a mad whirlwind of non-stop doing. They have to work very hard to make it possible for their baby to do nothing but be. If the parents do get a moment when all the chores are done and the baby is sleeping peacefully, the chances are they will sit down gratefully and do nothing. Nothing except be. Those parents are very aware that their life has gone out of balance since their baby was born. Too much to do, not enough time for self. But they also know that it's temporary and soon they'll be able to get back to normal. However, for most of us, normal is actually quite out of balance. Too much doing and not enough being. You may wonder why that matters, but it seems that many of the problems people experience arise from that failure to spend time just being. Stress, for instance, seems to build up when we don't allow time in our lives for being. Most of us only go into being mode on holiday, and perhaps not even then. A really busy person will often say that it takes the first week of a holiday to wind down, and only the second week really feels like a holiday. Perhaps you immediately reacted by thinking that there isn't the time. You have so much to do every day that you can only just manage it. In fact, you never really feel quite on top of your workload. And if you took time out for being, well, nothing would ever get done. There are two answers to this. One is that you have simply taken on too much and may need to re-examine your life and your commitments. The other is that even a short break for time to just be will send you back to your doing, invigorated and energized, so that you will achieve much more. Keynote: mindfulness is a way of redressing the imbalance between being and doing. Exercise: do nothing. Since you're listening to this audiobook, you're already in a situation where there are no other calls on your time, or where you've chosen to ignore those calls for the time that you're listening. So there's no excuse for not doing this exercise. Turn the audiobook off and do nothing for 2 minutes. There's no need to time this exactly. Look out of the window or close your eyes. Just breathe and be. Questions: how did that feel? Think about it for a moment. If you're anything like me, the moment you stopped listening and decided to do nothing, the thoughts started rushing in. Thoughts about the audiobook, perhaps, or about what you need to do next, what you're going to eat later on, and whether you've got time for all the things you need to do in the next few hours. So even though your body was just being, your mind was still doing. In your notebook, record how it felt to do this exercise. One of the challenges of mindfulness is to gently retrain your mind to accept just being. If you're still wondering why, think of your mind as like a muscle. It needs to work and it needs to rest. Even the most dedicated Olympic athletes have rest periods programmed into their training schedule. In fact, these rests are essential, since muscles actually grow slightly larger during rest periods and cleanse themselves of waste products. Your mind is the same. It needs to rest as well as work. Being and doing and emotions. There is another good reason for learning to be as well as do, or perhaps I should say relearning, since as babies we were all naturally good at being. Doing mode, which most of us are in most of the time, is not appropriate for dealing with emotions. Doing mode looks for actions that will produce solutions, but that in turn can lead to knee-jerk reactions, especially to uncomfortable emotions. We react to the pain of the emotion with an overpowering desire to make it stop. For instance, someone who is sad will look for a quick fix to make the sadness go away. Chocolate, shopping, alcohol. That may not seem too terrible, although all three can cause problems if taken to extremes. But what about anger? If you feel angry and you make it go away by taking violent action or doing something else you'll regret later, such as walking out of a relationship, then the bad effects of the knee jerk can be devastating. Doing mode is all about action and immediate responses. In doing mode, we look for solutions, set goals, and generally try to get on with things. In being mode, we let go of trying to fix everything and simply look at things as they are. When it comes to dealing with emotions, that space is where you gain a sense of perspective. There will be more about mindfulness and emotions later in the audiobook, but for now, let's concentrate on learning to be. Exercise. Take another 2 minutes away from listening and do nothing. This time, don't just let your body do nothing. Allow yourself to stop thinking too. Thoughts will enter your mind, of course, but when they do, try to leave them alone. Sometimes it helps to think of them as just floating through your mind. Questions. In your notebook, record how it felt to do this exercise. Keynote. I used to have trouble letting thoughts float through until I was talking about it with a friend. I asked how she did it. Well, she said, I don't bother with them and they don't bother with me. Automatic pilot. There's a funny thing about doing mode, because even though it's hard to let go of thinking, it's also true that a lot of the time we cruise along busily, not really thinking about what we're actually doing. In other words, we're on autopilot. This is not the same as being in being mode, because on autopilot, we don't really notice anything, and we are probably thinking about something else entirely. Let's say you're taking the short walk from the car park to your place of work. It takes only a few minutes and you've got your head down, perhaps already thinking about the day ahead, or maybe talking to a friend on your mobile. In that short walk, you notice nothing about your surroundings. Maybe the tree at the edge of the car park has flowered or lost its leaves if it's autumn, but you don't notice. Maybe someone has dropped a £20 note or left their car unlocked with the keys in the ignition. You don't notice because you're on autopilot. When you're on autopilot, you tend not to notice any of these things. Mindfulness encourages you to stop, switch off the autopilot, and really connect with your immediate experience. Exercise. Being and noticing. Take another 2 minutes to just be. Let your mind and your body do nothing, but allow your attention to focus on your surroundings. whether you are listening on the train or in bed, become aware of the weight of your body against the support, the feel of your clothes against your skin, the air on your face, the light, the temperature, the motion or lack of motion. Questions. In your notebook, record how it felt to do this exercise. Of course, in many ways, autopilot is useful. If you're a driver, you probably remember being a learner and struggling to remember all the different skills you had to master to drive a car. Once those skills became automatic, you could focus on the really important business of being a safe driver. You could give your whole attention to the road ahead, the traffic and pedestrians around you, instead of worrying whether you were going to manage your next gear change, or even being distracted by the feel of the steering wheel or the warm air on your face from the ventilation system. The same is true of any skill. We need to practice it until aspects of it become automatic, and then we can move on to the next level. Autopilot is also very useful when we're in doing mode. Right now, outside my window, I can see a crabapple tree smothered in blossom. If I kept being distracted by its beauty, I would never get this book written. I'm in doing mode, and that's where I need to be right now. The problem with autopilot is that you can simply forget to come out of it. It's a question of balance again. When I'm ready for a break from writing, instead of picking up the phone or getting a coffee, maybe I should look at the tree for a moment. A small moment of mindfulness like that is an instant charge-up for my mental batteries. Because autopilot is quite inappropriate for managing emotions, if you forget to switch it off, or it gets stuck in the on position, then that can be disastrous for relationships. Exercise. A little taste of mindfulness. Eating is one of the things many of us do on automatic pilot. We often eat while barely noticing the food, perhaps because we are in a rush or distracted by the television or radio. This classic mindfulness exercise, devised by Jon Kabat-Zinn, is normally done with a single raisin, but you can do it with a segment of orange or any small piece of food. You start by picking up the raisin and observing it closely for several minutes. Examine its colour, texture, weight and smell, and see how it reflects the light. Then, put the raisin to your lips and touch it with your tongue. See whether the two sensations are different in any way. Put the raisin to your mouth, but don't chew or swallow it. Instead, feel it in your mouth against your teeth, cheeks, and tongue. When you have fully explored the raisin, then you can chew and swallow it. Questions. In your notebook, record how it felt to do this exercise. Perhaps you felt rather foolish and self-conscious. I certainly did the first time I did it. Nevertheless, it is worth doing. Eating a raisin mindfully reminds you that there is a whole world of experience in one tiny piece of food. It is also a good example of what it feels like to come out of autopilot and doing mode. If you really focus on eating the raisin slowly and with full appreciation, then you will stop doing and stop thinking about all your other concerns. For just a few minutes, you'll have been fully mindful. Consider the following points. Babies live in being mode all of the time. Adults live in doing mode much of the time. Adults need to spend time just being. Being gives your mind a rest period. Doing mode is about taking action and seeing results. Doing mode is not helpful for managing emotions. In doing mode, we are often on automatic pilot. In autopilot, we are not aware of the present moment. Autopilot is not helpful for managing emotions. Autopilot can get stuck in the on position. The next chapter takes you further into the core aspects of mindfulness. You will learn more about becoming fully present in the moment, accepting of whatever is happening and whatever you're feeling, and how to achieve this state of being without judgment and with kindness to yourself. Chapter 2: The Core Aspects of Mindfulness. In this chapter, you will learn the value of daily meditation, how to live in the moment, about acknowledgement and acceptance, how to be kind to yourself. Mindful living has two components. You can learn to be mindful in your everyday life, and this is helpful in all sorts of ways. You can learn mindful ways of increasing your enjoyment of life and handling difficulties, which can be brought into play at any point of the day. The other component of mindfulness is meditation, which is done in a more formal way by making a commitment and setting time aside for it. Although meditation has been well known in the West for a long time, it was, for instance, very fashionable in the 1960s, many of us still find the concept a little strange. However, once you start meditating regularly, it soon starts to feel like second nature. Here's a thought. Remember, meditation is for everyone. You don't have to wear special clothes, chant, or turn into a hippie. Meditation is the key skill for mindfulness, and it is meditation practice that creates the ability to bring mindfulness into everyday life. Think of a musician practicing scales, or all the hours a footballer spends at the training ground. Practice is essential for any skill, and practice is always more than just a rehearsal. The musician acquires mental discipline and focus during practice. The footballer becomes stronger and fitter during training. Both can take what they've acquired into their everyday life. Meditation is usually done daily at special times that you set aside for it. However, the great thing about mindfulness is that it encourages you to be extremely tolerant. So if you don't manage to meditate every day, you won't need to feel terrible about it or feel like a failure. Of course, as with any new skill, the more you put in, the more you will get out. However, if you are only able to put a little in, that's all right. Slow progress is better than no progress. Living in the moment. As you already know, mindfulness derives from Buddhist philosophy, and a key component of that is the idea that only the present moment is real. The past exists only in your memory, and the future exists only in your imagination. Mindfulness is a way of bringing yourself completely into the present so that you experience it as fully as possible. Like so many of the concepts behind mindfulness, we do already understand it in our culture, but we use a different vocabulary. How about quality time? Doesn't that mean being with whatever is going on? Usually we're referring to parenting, 100%. In the moment and totally focused. You've already had a taste of this in the previous exercises. Other exercises throughout the audiobook will also encourage you to live in the moment. Of course, the past and the future are still important. Looking back into the past is how we learn from our mistakes, and we need to look into the future in order to make plans. And thinking about both can be a source of great pleasure. But constantly ruminating and dwelling on things that can't be changed, the past, or that might never happen, the future, is an unhealthy habit. Exercise. Immerse yourself in a mindful object. Stop listening for a moment. Look around you and choose an object to focus on. Spend a few moments looking at it and noting all its qualities. If you can pick it up and handle it, notice everything about it: shape, colour, texture, temperature, size, smell, and so on. If you can, be non-verbal about this. Don't try to give names to the qualities of the object, but instead immerse yourself in whatever it has to offer you. If you're listening to this in a public place, you may feel inhibited and worry that people will think you're acting strangely. Don't do anything that makes you feel uncomfortable. You can always do this exercise later at home. Questions. Record how it felt to do this exercise. Don't describe the object or anything you noticed about it. Keep that part of the experience as non-verbal. Just record your reactions. Acknowledgement and acceptance. When you're being mindful, either during meditation or in your everyday life, you remind yourself how precious the present moment is and how much it's to be savored. But what about those present moments that are unpleasant, scary, or sad? Our natural instinct is to shrink away from pain, whether it's physical or emotional. And yet mindfulness asks you to stay with it and experience it fully. How can that be helpful? The answer to this question lies in the mindful qualities of acknowledgement and acceptance. Whatever is going on in the present moment, in order to fully experience it, you have to acknowledge that it's there. If your mind is thinking about something else, then you aren't really acknowledging it, which is why mindfulness requires focus. But you also aren't acknowledging the moment if you're turning away because something painful or unpleasant is going on. Let's say that someone is rude to you on the telephone, really rude, and it upsets you. Your instant reaction will depend on your character. You might be rude right back, or put the phone down and burst into tears. But then you're quite likely to do something to make the pain go away, to calm yourself down and move on as quickly as possible. This often doesn't work, so that hours later you're still inwardly fuming or tearful about that rude person on the phone. If you approach the situation mindfully rather than running away from the upset, you'll start by acknowledging that it has happened. Surprisingly enough, doing that can often reduce the intensity of your upset feelings. So that's one way in which mindfulness can help with difficult moments. The next step is to learn to accept your emotional response for what it is. Emotions can be joyful or painful, but they are always temporary. Instead of climbing right inside your pain and engaging with it, take a step back. Accept that you're hurting and that it will pass. It's not quite so surprising that doing this means the painful emotion passes much more quickly, and this is another way that mindfulness helps with difficulties. Thought to remember. Whether an emotion is joyful or painful, it is always transitory. Another word for this process is detachment, and this is another concept that can seem a little alien to non-Buddhists. Yet again, we do understand it, but with a different vocabulary. Have you ever been told to count to 10 when you feel yourself getting angry? That is just a different way of expressing detachment. In the time it takes you to count to 10, the anger will start to subside, and you'll be able to handle the situation more rationally. Acknowledgement and acceptance are not the same thing as resignation. Resignation implies that there is no hope of change, that you're stuck with whatever it is, whereas once you have acknowledged and accepted what is happening for you in the present moment, there is nothing to stop you making changes. In fact, change becomes easier. Think about how small children experience life. They tend to be totally in the moment, and in that sense, they are naturally mindful. On the other hand, they have no ability to detach and observe their emotions as they arise, and are so totally caught up in them that every small problem is, to them, a tragedy. So in order to be fully mindful, we have to acquire the capacity for detachment as well as the ability to engage with the present moment. Here's an exercise. Acknowledge and accept. Think back to an unpleasant experience that you had recently. For this exercise, choose something that was mildly distressing. Later on, when you have confidence in mindfulness, you may choose to explore deeper problems. Recall the experience and allow yourself to feel the distressing emotions. Acknowledge them and accept them. Don't try to change anything or rewrite the events in your head. Questions. In your notebook, record your response to this exercise. Later on, after you've had more time to absorb the principles of mindfulness, repeat the exercise and see whether your response has changed. Being kind to yourself. A big element in mindfully acknowledging something is to be non-judgmental about it. Let's return to the example where someone has been rude to you on the phone. If your instant reaction is to lose your temper and be rude right back, then afterwards you might feel badly about this, or you might spend time righteously justifying your behaviour in order to stop yourself feeling badly. The mindful approach is to accept that this has happened. You lost your temper. You can't go back and change it. Now you feel badly about it. Accept that too. Don't spend time beating yourself up, but simply acknowledge and accept that you are experiencing a difficult emotion and treat yourself with compassion. On the other hand, perhaps your reaction was to put the telephone down and burst into tears. Then you feel badly because you didn't stand up for yourself. You let the other person walk all over you. Again, the mindful approach is to acknowledge your reaction, to accept it, something in the past that can't be changed, and to adopt a kindly, non-judging attitude. Exercise. Go back to the unpleasant experience in the previous exercise. Recall the emotions, which you now acknowledge and accept. If you judged yourself in any way, forgive yourself. Even forgive yourself for being judgmental. The habits of a lifetime can take a while to change. It's important to be kind to yourself while working on all the exercises in this audiobook. Don't think in terms of success and failure. These aren't relevant concepts. You aren't sitting an exam or trying to reach a certain standard. Each person becomes mindful in their own way and at their own pace, and there's no need to compare yourself with anyone else. Try to feel a sense of warmth and friendliness while you're doing the exercise, and approach each new one with a sense of gentle curiosity. Any difficulties that arise are simply another chance to practice mindfulness. Here's an exercise. Let go of goals. For this exercise, you need to choose your place carefully, because the idea is to stroll about without any direction and without trying to get somewhere. Don't do it anywhere near traffic, cliff edges, or anything else that could be dangerous if you become too absorbed in the exercise. A park, a beach, an open countryside are all suitable. Simply start strolling around with no desire to be anywhere or to achieve anything. Take your time and let your feet carry you where they will, while at the same time being fully engaged in the sights, sounds, and smells of your environment. If your mind starts filling up with thoughts, try to let them go. This is not a time for thinking. Consider the following points. Mindfulness consists of formal meditation and everyday mindful living. Practice is more than just rehearsal. Try to meditate daily. Be kind to yourself if you miss some days. Being mindful means living in the moment. Even negative experiences can be lived fully. Acknowledge and accept whatever is happening. You can detach from your emotions. Be kind to yourself. Learn to let go of goals. The next chapter explains the various ways in which mindfulness can help us in many aspects of life and how it can increase happiness. Chapter 3, The Benefits of Mindfulness. In this chapter, you will learn how mindfulness can be helpful in many aspects of life, how mindfulness increases happiness, about the connection between mindfulness and flow. In recent years, there has been extensive research into the benefits of mindfulness, and it is consistently shown to be helpful for both physical health, such as reducing high blood pressure, and mental health, such as reducing anxiety. Of course, we should always keep an open mind about research. For instance, much research involves using university students, and they are not a typical cross-section of the population, especially since the research looks only at the type of student who volunteers for research. But even with these reservations in mind, it does seem as if learning mindfulness is likely to be beneficial for a wide range of problems. It's also helpful to people who don't have specific problems, but who want to improve the quality of their life. There are various ways in which mindfulness can be helpful, such as taking the sting out of negative emotions, taking you away from unhelpful habits of thinking, restoring balance to the two sides of your brain, giving you time out from the increasing sensory overload of the modern world, restoring your natural rhythms, teaching you to live with yourself. Mindfulness and happiness. What makes you happy? Many people asked this question will pick on special events that made them happy. Falling in love, the birth of a child, or getting their desired exam results. With this type of event, something happened that brought you entirely into the present moment. You were so happy that you couldn't think about anything else. You lost all sense of yourself and were totally caught up in the moment. Mindfulness encourages you to engage in the present moment for more of the time, not just when something amazing and special is happening in your life. When you do that, you're more likely to feel happy. Here's an exercise. Think back to the last time you felt totally happy. Take plenty of time to savor the memory. Questions. Make notes about what you were doing at this happy time and what was going on in your life. When people are questioned more closely about happiness, some surprising results emerge. The old adage, money can't buy you happiness, is only true up to a point. In fact, it can buy quite a lot of happiness if it means meeting your basic needs, enough to eat, a safe place to sleep, and so on. After that, people get happier if they can have a little extra, clothes, television, holidays. But quite quickly, there comes a point where any increase of income, and therefore of material wealth, makes no difference at all to happiness. It also seems to be true that many people become happier as they grow older, perhaps because they are more comfortable in their own skin. Mindfulness and flow. Although joyful events can bring a great surge of happiness, for many people the happiest times of their lives turn out to be when they were busily engaged doing something that they found totally engrossing. The Hungarian psychologist Mihai Csikszentmihalyi coined the term flow to describe the experience, although it's also known as being in the zone. He's identified various aspects of flow, all of which need to be present before flow occurs. Intense involvement with what you're doing. Pleasure in what you're doing that creates a kind of ecstasy. Certainty that you know what you need to do. Feeling competent, and that the task is a challenge, but within your abilities. No sense of time passing. Finding reward in the activity itself. Keynote. The happiest times of our lives are often those when we are totally absorbed in something. My father used to rather touchingly say that the happiest time of his life was when I was small and he was working hard, as well as thoroughly enjoying family life. Of course, he used to say, I didn't realise it at the time. This sense of total engagement is very much what mindfulness is about. It's easy to see that an artist or athlete might have that kind of passionate involvement with what they're doing, but most of us are not that gifted, or we haven't been able to give our whole lives to our passion. Most of us spend most of our time doing the things we need to do, buying necessities, paying bills, cleaning, going to work, in order to make it possible to do the things we really want to do, take holidays, spend time with family and friends, have evenings out, pursue hobbies. Keynote. Mindful living is a way of engaging with even the dullest task to create flow, rather than waiting for the all too few moments when we are free to do what we most want to do. For me, it's easy to find flow when I'm writing or doing research. My big challenge is to bring the same sense of commitment to housework. Questions. Make a list of those experiences that give you flow. It can be anything that does it for you. even things that other people struggle with, like housework. Whatever is on your list, they are bound to be activities that you quite naturally and easily become absorbed in. When you have flow or are in the zone, you are doing the things you love doing, and clearly you should try to structure your life, if at all possible, so that you get plenty of opportunities to do them. Nevertheless, there will always be other tedious things that need to be done, and for many of us, those activities will take up the majority of our time. If we could generate flow for mundane activities, how much better life would be. The elements of flow. If you look at your list of things that work for you, you'll probably find that they all have three elements in common. 1. Rules. Some activities have an obvious rule base, playing chess or tennis, for instance. In others, the rules are underlying. For example, I couldn't gain flow through writing unless I had absorbed the rules of language and literacy. Perhaps one reason I don't engage with housework is that I've never taken it seriously enough to learn the rules, and I still don't know whether you're supposed to dust before you vacuum or vice versa. Training. There is usually an element of skill in activities that create flow, and we acquire skills through training and practice. I always enjoyed reading as a child, but it was only when a new and inspirational teacher started to challenge me that I began to enjoy writing. Skills can be acquired informally too. I also get flow from gardening, and it's only when I watch a novice struggling to grow things that I realise how much skill I've acquired over the years. Ritual. People nearly always have a ritual, big or small, that eases them into the activity. For instance, a footballer will need to get changed, put on their boots, and so on, and most will do this in the same way each time. Some sports people are superstitious about the way they get ready, but for others it's simply the way they put themselves into the right mindset. Similarly, when I'm ready to write, I like to make a hot drink, sit down, check my emails, and then turn to the work in hand. The three elements in activities that produce flow are also found in mindfulness. There are very few rules in the strict sense, but there are ways of going about mindfulness that need to be adhered to. It certainly takes training, in the sense that you need to meditate regularly before you'll start to acquire the mental skills you'll need to become mindful. A little ritual that you always repeat before you start to meditate will help you get into the right mindset. You could use a little bell, light an incense stick, or have a special cushion or shawl, whatever works for you. Other sources of happiness. As well as flow, there are two other commonly identified sources of happiness. Small moments of temporary happiness can come from small things that give you pleasure. A piece of cake does it for me every time. At the other end of the scale, if you feel that your life has a purpose, then you're more likely to be happy. Doing something worthwhile, whether it's in your job, your family, or in a volunteering role, will greatly increase your happiness quotient. Mindfulness increases the intensity of both these types of happiness. If I eat my cake mindfully, I enjoy it far more than if I eat it while reading the paper with the radio on in the background. And anyone who studies mindfulness for long enough will eventually be brought to the realization that everything is interconnected, a concept which brings greater meaning to even small acts of kindness to other people. Consider the following points. Mindfulness can improve your physical and mental health. Mindfulness can improve your quality of life. Special events make us happy. Having our basic needs met makes us happy. Happiness increases as you grow older. Being totally engaged with something creates happiness through flow. Mindfulness encourages total engagement with all activities, however mundane. Flow requires rules, training, and rituals. Small events can also make us happy. A sense of purpose in life creates happiness. Before you take the next step towards achieving mindfulness, you need to consider the cautions and concerns set out in the next chapter. Chapter 4, Cautions and Concerns. In this chapter, you will learn how much to meditate, about the challenges and difficulties of meditating, about the need to have realistic expectations. There are a few things to consider before you make a commitment to mindfulness. If you're already working with a therapist or having help from your doctor for mental health difficulties, then be sure to tell them what you're planning. In the unlikely event that they advise you against starting mindfulness at this time, then leave it for now. You can always come back to it later. Once you've decided to give mindfulness a try, don't rush things. It's far better to work steadily, listening to and absorbing each chapter and taking your time over the exercises whenever you choose to do them. Mindfulness isn't a quick fix. How much to do? Once you start to do regular daily mindfulness practice, don't get caught up in the idea that more is better. If your early experiences of meditation are joyful, you might be tempted to spend more and more time meditating. Or you might be overly enthusiastic at the beginning, thinking that the more you do, the more quickly you'll get there. However, there is no there to get to. In a sense, you're already there. And the job of mindfulness is to help you understand and appreciate that. To get the full benefit of mindfulness, it is important to make a commitment to regular practice over a number of weeks. Many mindfulness courses run for 8 weeks, so that is a good length of time to aim for. By the end of that time, you will have found out whether mindfulness is for you and whether you want to make it a permanent part of your life. Clearly, you need to find a balance between doing too much and doing too little. If you do too much, you'll struggle to cope with everyday life and perhaps give up early. If you do too little, you won't learn enough about the benefits. It's usually thought that between 30 and 45 minutes is the optimum amount of time to give to a daily meditation session, in addition to small moments of mindfulness throughout the day. You'll find these increase quite naturally as mindfulness becomes more and more part of your life. I suggest that you start with quite a small commitment, perhaps as little as 5 minutes a day, and build it up slowly but steadily until you reach the right level for you. Exercise. Examine your schedule and think about your commitments. Ask yourself how you will fit daily meditation into your life. Questions. In your notebook, record your thoughts about how much time you think you realistically have available. We'll consider this further in the next chapter. It's important to be realistic about what you can manage, and it's far better to meet your commitment than to set the bar too high and then give up. So deciding to set aside 5 minutes a day and managing that will have more benefit than deciding to do 30 minutes twice a day, but actually only managing 5 minutes. Why some people struggle. There are various reasons why some people find it harder than others to do this kind of work. We've already looked at over-enthusiasm, and overly high expectations can have a similar effect. Being realistic about what you can do and what you are hoping for will greatly increase your chances of success. Questions. Do you have any worries about mindfulness and meditation? Make a list of them. Examine each one in the light of what you're learning as you listen. The information in this chapter should help lay your fears to rest. Tension. Meditation is in many ways the opposite of relaxation, but it does encourage release of tension. If you're very tense and wound up, your first few meditation sessions might be quite uncomfortable if that tension should happen to be suddenly released. This doesn't happen to everyone, but it's best to be forewarned. It can feel very odd if you suddenly relax, especially if you've been tense for years, perhaps without realizing it. Before I started mindful meditation, I tried using a relaxation CD at a very difficult time in my life. It sent me into the deepest sleep I've ever experienced, and waking up from it was very strange. It didn't do me any harm, and it was the first step in a long journey to a calmer life. Keynote. Everyone should allow themselves time for emerging from meditation. Spend a few minutes sitting quietly while you gradually pick up the reins of your daily life. Relaxation aims to release physical and mental tension. The simplest exercises concentrate on releasing muscle tension, and many people find that their mind relaxes in parallel with their body. Other types of relaxation exercise aim to create soothing mental pictures, such as a garden or a peaceful beach. These relax the mind, and often the body follows. In both cases, you enter a quiet and calm mental place where your awareness is lowered, rather like the time just before you fall asleep. In meditation, on the other hand, although you are both quiet and calm, your awareness is heightened. If you are aware of being very tense, you might like to practice some relaxation before moving on to meditation. Some people, however, feel too tense to relax and prefer to start with meditation. We cover this in Chapter 24. Exercise. Do a relaxation exercise. Sit or lie quietly in a comfortable position. Allow your breathing to slow down and become calmer. After a minute or so, scrunch your hands into fists, squeeze them tightly, then open out your fingers and relax your hands. Now work your way round your body, tensing up various muscles, holding them for a moment, and then relaxing them. Start at your feet and work your way up. Don't forget the muscles in your face. Another good way to let go of tension is to have a massage, and again, you might like to try this before moving on to meditation. Too slow. Some of us only feel comfortable if we're busy all the time and operating at top speed. Some people find even holidays difficult, and no doubt we've all seen the person by the pool or on the beach still busily checking emails on their mobile phone. If you are like that, it can feel like a waste of time to stop, slow down and meditate, or do nothing, for a whole half hour. It might help if you think of it as time to recharge your batteries, which will then help you function far more efficiently when you go back to your normal speed. Fear of change. Human beings have developed from the Stone Age to the present age by constantly making changes, and yet we all seem to have an inherent fear of change. In fact, it seems from the research that mindfulness practice doesn't change people, fundamentally. You'll still be the same person, but you'll function in different, healthier ways. The various aspects of mindfulness will seem strange at first, but, as with anything new, the more you work with them, the more familiar they will become. Once you establish a routine and a set of habits around mindfulness, you'll find that you will soon be able to assimilate the practice into your daily life. Too solitary. Mindful meditation requires you to spend time alone, and yet human beings are naturally gregarious. Our present culture encourages us to be in constant communication with others, so that even if we are on our own, we are often phoning, texting, or on a social networking site. If you find it difficult to think of just being with yourself and no one else, then remember that you can start with 5 minutes a day. Just like the busy person, you might find it easier if you think of the quiet time alone as a chance to recharge yourself. Fear of pleasure. If you've been unhappy for a long time, you may well have made friends with this state. Unhappiness has become your norm, and you may be reluctant to try a different way of living. This is a variation on the fear of change, so you should ease yourself in as gently as you like. Remember, kindness to yourself is a core component of mindfulness. Don't, however, decide that mindfulness practice is simply another chore, something you find hard work, and therefore another reason for being unhappy. Unrealistic expectations. Mindfulness is not about finding a quick answer to all of life's problems. It's much more about learning to accept that life will always have problems. If you go into meditation in the full flood of doing mode, you'll probably be looking for measurable outcomes and expecting to get the hang of it after one or two sessions. It's quite disconcerting then to find that there is no it to get the hang of. There is no good or bad meditation. There is just meditation. Each session will be different. Possibly the commonest reason for becoming disheartened and giving up is that most of us find it is so difficult to stop thinking. The answer to this is to accept that thoughts will always appear during meditation, and the important thing is your attitude to them. In other words, don't get cross with yourself for having thoughts, and don't feel that you failed in some way. Instead, try not to get involved with the thought. Just notice it and let it drift away. If you do suddenly become aware in the middle of a meditation session that your attention has wandered away with a thought and you've been busily engaged in thinking, then bring your awareness back to meditating and let go of the thought. You may have to do this many times in a session, but don't let yourself think of this as a failure. It just happens sometimes. And each time you lead yourself away from your thoughts, you will learn a little more and you will gently teach your mind to accept that you are going to persevere with meditation. Exercise. Just take a minute. Sit comfortably where you can see a clock that shows the seconds and allows a minute to pass. While the minute passes, focus totally on your breathing. Don't try to change your breathing or control it. Just let it happen. After all, your body breathes quite naturally without any interference from you. This short exercise is good preparation for longer sessions. Repeat it a few times, extending the time you sit for. If you still have reservations, keep listening. Don't feel you have to start meditating until you are quite ready. Consider the following points. Tell your doctor or therapist before you start meditation. Be prepared to meditate daily for several weeks. Half an hour to 45 minutes is the usual length of a session. Do less if this is reasonable for you. Start with relaxation if you need to. Accept the need to slow down during meditation. Meditation won't change you fundamentally. Accept that meditation is a solitary activity. Allow yourself to enjoy mindfulness. Have realistic expectations. In the next chapter, you'll find out what resources you will need for mindfulness meditation, both mental and physical, and how to find the best meditation posture for you. Chapter 5. Resources needed for meditation. In this chapter, you will learn how to organize yourself for meditation, postures for meditation, what mental qualities are needed for meditation. Formal meditation is the basis on which mindfulness is built, and in order to give yourself the best chance of developing a good practice, there are certain things you'll need to think about first. You will need to consider the best time and place for your meditation practice, as well as paying attention to your posture and how to develop the mental qualities you need. When to meditate. Since 30 to 45 minutes seems to be the optimum time to spend meditating, you will need to give some serious thought to how you're going to manage this. Many meditators commit to two sessions, at least 4 hours apart, which means that they meditate for between an hour and a half each day. One session first thing in the morning and one in the early evening seems to work well, even if the sessions are shorter than the optimum. Of course, your schedule may make this difficult or even impossible. For many people, weekend routines are quite different from weekdays, and shift workers have even more complicated lives. Only you can work out the best way to approach this. One simple option is to get up an hour earlier than normal and meditate in the peace of the early morning. Note, some people find meditation highly energizing. If that turns out to be the case for you, don't do it at bedtime. Here's a thought. One session a day, even a very short session, is better than no session at all. Whatever you choose to do, make it regular and realistic, and be sure to include enough time to emerge gradually from meditation, so you can sit quietly for a while afterwards. The element of repetition is extremely important. Nobody acquires a new skill by just doing it once, and the more times you repeat something, the more your brain absorbs and internalizes it. Research has shown that when we start any new activity, it creates new pathways in the brain, and with each repetition, pathways grow stronger. This is known as neuroplasticity, and it's an exciting new development in our understanding of how the brain works. If you find it difficult to imagine how you'll find the time, think of all the routine things that you do manage to do, from cleaning your teeth to paying your bills. If you place meditation on that list and make it a non-negotiable part of your life, you'll soon settle into a workable routine. If you worry about spending too long in meditation and missing something important, such as leaving for work or picking up the children, then by all means set a timer. Avoid one with a loud, strident ringer, though, and don't sit waiting for it to ring. If you reach the end of the meditation before the timer goes off, that's fine. Make the decision to stop and then actually stop. Questions. You've already looked at your schedule and begun to decide where meditation might fit into it. Now consider this in more detail. Where to meditate? You'll need a quiet place where you can be on your own with no distractions. For many people, this means their bedroom, which is fine, but any other private, safe place will be equally as good. I like to meditate in my bedroom, but I have to make the bed first and put away any bedside reading. Turn off your mobile and unplug the landline. Turn off any other electronic equipment in the room, such as a television or computer. Explain to other people that you can't be disturbed during the time you've set aside for meditating. If there are young children around, then make sure that another adult is responsible for them. You can't meditate while listening out for the sounds of trouble. It can be helpful at first to always meditate in the same place and carry out the same little rituals of turning things off and arranging the room as a way of putting yourself into the right mindset. Wherever you choose to meditate, there are bound to be some external noises, distant traffic, a car door slamming, even bird singing. Accepting these and continuing with your meditation is part of the learning process. Questions. Decide where you will meditate and record in your notebook any changes you'd like to make to the location to create a peaceful atmosphere. If at all possible, add the following to your meditation sessions. Subdued light in the room. During the day, position yourself with your back to the window. Comfortable clothing. Wear something loose and easy with no tight belts, cuffs or neck. If possible, take your shoes off. Be sure to be warm enough. Keynote. Whatever you're doing, body language is very important. It often tells us more about how someone is really feeling than the words they say. For some reason, we find it easier to lie with our words than with our bodies. It's also true that this can work in reverse. Body language reflects how you feel. But if you change your body language, you can change how you feel. If you're feeling down, but you stand up a little straighter and try to smile, then you're likely to start feeling a little better. I'm always interested in studying photographs of smiling celebrities on the red carpet. If you look at their hands, they are often clenched, telling quite a different story of underlying tension. Finding the right posture. The power of body language is why posture is so important when you're meditating. You need to find a posture that supports meditation. Some forms of meditation have strict requirements for posture, such as the full lotus position, which has to be held despite any discomfort. Learning to do this is part of the commitment the meditator makes. However, for the purposes of practical mindfulness meditation, the requirements are less rigorous. When you're using mindfulness in other ways during everyday life, no special postures are needed. You will need to find a posture that is comfortable for you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.